right, good morning and welcome to the Ninth Circuit. Before we get started, I know we have one counsel joining remotely. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, I can. Thank you, Your Honor.
Great. We can hear you and we can see you, so I think we're good to go. We have a number of cases, three cases that have been submitted on the briefs. So I'll just recite those for the record. Rojas Lazaro versus Garland, Tikas Galeas versus Garland, and Martinez versus Garland. And that leaves us three cases for oral argument this morning. We will start with William Fletcher versus the Idaho Department of Corrections. This is case number 21-35128. I just remind counsel that your timer is showing you the full time that you have left. So if you are the appellant and want to reserve any time, if you want to let us know, we'll do our best to try to help you out with that. And with that, we'll start with argument. And so, Mr. Woofter, I think you're going first.
Thank you, Judge Forrest. May it please the court. I'm Daniel Woofter, appearing on behalf of plaintiff appellant William Fletcher. I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal, please. Mr. Fletcher has suffered and continues to suffer humiliation and ridicule because the state cast him as a sex offender, even though all now agree he was not convicted of a sex crime. He is entitled to the injunctive relief he seeks because, in the words of the Supreme Court's decision in Vitek, the state's requirement that he undergo mandatory behavior modification programs have engendered adverse social consequences to him. According to the state, Mr. Fletcher is only entitled to adversarial process before the state formally labels him a sex offender to meet the stigma plus test that applies in government defamation cases. But the state does not dispute that the Supreme Court has never applied that test in the prisoner parole context. And in any event, the state took the formal public position in its own briefing to Idaho's courts nearly 10 years ago that Mr. Fletcher should not be permitted to serve out his sentence on probation because he would not admit to being a convicted sex offender and, quote, was convicted of a sex offense and therefore considered a sex offender, end quote. He is entitled to summary judgment on his claim for injunctive relief. This court asked what effect the end of Mr. Fletcher's probationary term next month would have on the case. Given how clear the violation is here, the court could enjoin the remainder of his sex offense-related probationary terms now, pending this court's decision. But even if his injunctive relief claims become moot, he still has live damages claims, and all he seeks is leave to replead them. For the period he was incarcerated, Mr. Fletcher could obviously name the correct defendants and plead damages claims. The state does not even try to argue otherwise and thus waives any objection to that relief. For Mr. Fletcher's parole-related damages claim, the state only argues that he failed to sue Sandy Jones and Karen Clifford in their individual capacities, and that in any event, they are entitled to absolute immunity. Even setting aside that the district court should have read the complaint liberally, as brought against Ms. Jones and Ms. Clifford in their individual capacities, here, too, it would not be futile for Mr. Fletcher to amend because, quote, parole officers are not entitled to absolute immunity for conduct arising from their duty to supervise parolees, end quote. And even if these are the wrong defendants for that kind of claim, Mr. Fletcher could easily name the correct ones. I'm happy to take the court's questions.
Well, I have some questions about the new documents that have been submitted to the court. Do you want to address those?
Sure, I'm happy to address any questions regarding the new documents submitted to the court last Friday.
Do you have objections to it being admitted?
I don't object to this court taking judicial notice of those documents any more than the state should object to this court taking judicial notice of their briefing in the Idaho state courts.
But what we would
object to is the state relying on these to create new arguments that were not raised in its briefing in this case.
Yeah.
And for those arguments, we did not have a chance to address them. So, we have, of course, no issue with the court taking judicial notice of these documents. What these judicially noticeable documents do or do not provide in terms of what it means for this case can't go beyond the scope of what the state argued in its response brief in opposition.
Yeah, well, I that was a lot of boilerplate, counsel. I'm not exactly sure how it helps us here, but let me go ahead and ask my question. So, one thing is, I'm a little disturbed that neither side put the plea agreement in the record, because it does seem to me to be relevant, because it raises the question that that he has consented to all of this, that he knew from the outset that he was going to be treated for psychosexual evaluations and treatment. and that it would also be a condition of his probation. And if so, even assuming that we find that there's a liberty interest here at stake, it seems that he's got all the, had all the process that was due.
I don't think that's correct, Your Honor. The state did not argue that in its briefing and response. Yeah,
I understand the argument. The argument feels very technical at this point, counsel. I've got a document in front of me that says that your client knew that his that he was going to be treated this way in prison and that he would be treated this way on probation. So where's the due process violation?
I don't think that the document did clearly set that forth for Mr. Fletcher, Your Honor. It does contain boilerplate and, you know, yeses and nos that he acknowledged for before he was going into his prison term.
Let me read you the paragraphs that I'm interested in. Paragraph 4, the defendant is to cooperate with the pre-sentence investigation and to cooperate in obtaining a psychosexual evaluation with Dr. Michael Johnston. The offer is not contingent on the defendant's risk to reoffend, but the defendant must be amenable to treatment. 5, the defendant agrees to cooperate in obtaining a mental health evaluation and substance abuse evaluation if requested. Paragraph 11, the defendant agrees to follow all recommendations of the psychosexual evaluation should he be placed on probation after the retained jurisdiction. So,
Your Honor,
why isn't that an agreement, that an understanding that he was going to be treated for a sex offense, even if he wasn't going to be subject labeled as a sex offender?
Your Honor, I think it is incredibly important here to remember that the state did not raise this argument in its response. And therefore, even if this court were to find that kind of argument persuasive, that is not the basis of what has occurred
okay.
in the...
Counsel, I really appreciate the waiver argument. And I think the waiver argument, is, I'm going to ask the state about that. But I really would like you to address this on the merits, and you've avoided that to this point.
So what all... No, I apologize. I'm not attempting to avoid Your Honor's question. I just think that the waiver argument is so strong, it bears repeating. But with regard to what he agreed to in this plea agreement, the one thing that Mr. Fletcher was not aware of when he signed this plea agreement was that he would, in prison, be required to attend group therapy, sex offender rehabilitation...
said that he would be amenable to treatment in the paragraph referring to psychosexual evaluation, what did he think was going to happen?
You know, Your Honor, I think that my unsophisticated client believed that those would not apply to him because he refused multiple plea offers from the government that were based on his alleged sex crimes. And multiple times he said so. He said to the state, I will not agree to this because I did not commit a sex crime. Indeed, he even entered an Alford plea, still refusing the factual basis, saying, you know, I did not do anything but give my stepdaughter a bath. That is what he believed he was entering into. Now, and if the state can
counsel,
get
the Judge Windmill's order at SER 25, that's page 7 of his order, footnote 2 goes through and specifies what your client was alleged to have done. And he concludes that there is no genuine dispute that plaintiff committed the crime of felony injury to a child and describes the acts that your client committed in the bathtub with his stepdaughter. Now, is Judge Windmill wrong on that one?
Your Honor, no. Judge Windmill correctly notes what my client was pleading to, which was not a sex crime, and then notes what it was that was alleged to have occurred. But that is no different than what happened to the plaintiff in Neal, who was alleged in the indictment to have committed horrendous acts of sexual assault in the course of committing his crimes, but he there too refused to admit to a sex crime.
Yes,
and this court held the state to its burden. If it wants to...
But I don't think you've dealt with what Judge Windmill said. There is no genuine dispute that plaintiff committed the crime of felony injury. That's what your client pled to, and then describes the act, which has a sexual component to it. So yes, your client didn't plead to a sex crime, and he's not being labeled as a sex offender. He's not required to register, but that doesn't mean that there wasn't some kind of sexual component to the act that for which he did plead guilty. And for which he had told the state that he would submit to evaluation and treatment.
Your Honor, I think that is no different than what this court recognized in Neal. There, and I'm quoting from the court's opinion, Neal's indictment and pre-sentence investigation report included allegations that he engaged in sexual misconduct during the course of his crimes, even though the sexual offenses had been dismissed. And he was classified as a sex offender and assigned to a medium security classification. And that's at Neal's opinion 131 F3rd 822. You know,
there are no facts in Neal, however, that go along the lines of the plea agreement that we're just getting in this case, indicating that Neal knew from the outset of his sentence that he was going to have to go through an evaluation and perhaps treatment related to sexual behaviors. Is that correct?
I don't think that's quite correct, Your Honor, because in Neal, the SOTA program had already been the law, and that program required anyone, regardless of offense, to undergo these kinds of evaluations to see if there was a sexual offense risk of those inmates. So he was on the same notice as my client, who accepted.
I'm not sure. Is that really fair? If it's just a matter of sort of generally applicable law or regulation that poses those issues versus the person's specific plea agreement that they have an opportunity to look at and make a decision about before they complete their sentencing process. Is that really a fair analogy to say that generally applicable law gives you the same notice as your specific plea agreement in your specific case?
I want to make 2 points on this, Your Honor. I think that it does give you the same notice because, you know, it's replete in case law and black letter law that criminal defendants are imputed with the knowledge of the laws that they are alleged to have violated. And that kind of law that goes to probationary terms and eligibility falls within that realm. And two, the state argues itself that many of the probationary terms that they put in his probation requirements when he was put on probation recently don't apply here. So to the extent that his own specific, and one of those conditions, according to the state, is, for example, polysomnograph testing, which they say has never been imposed on Mr. Fletcher. So to the extent the state gets to argue, oh, some of those conditions certainly wouldn't apply, they're boilerplate, I think Mr. Fletcher should be waiver, but on top of waiver, it shouldn't be imputed to Mr. Fletcher that he might think that some of these conditions don't apply to him because he refused to plead guilty to a sex crime.
But in the same moment that he didn't plead guilty to a sex crime, he's agreeing to terms that specifically reference sexual evaluation and perhaps treatment.
Much like the state said that he would be required to undergo penile polysomnograph testing in his probationary terms, but have never exercised that right. They still say that they have the right to exercise it. So, I don't think it's unfair to say that Mr. Fletcher also thought that some of these terms would not apply because he was adamant that he had not committed a sex crime, and he was adamant that he would not plead guilty to having done so.
Can I ask you,
I'd like to reserve the remainder of my
time. Can I ask you on a different aspect of this? You say that Judge Windmill should have given your client an opportunity to amend. What exactly would this amended complaint have looked like? I know it would be against these two individuals in their individual capacity, but what would the claim be at that point? And you're trying to draw the distinction between, there's no immunity if you are supervising, but there would be immunity when you're imposing the conditions, if I'm understanding you correctly. So what would this complaint look like against these two individuals?
So against these two individuals, it would be against them. And the state even recognizes that, at least as to Ms. Clifford, she was only there as in a supervisory role, and therefore that the state admits itself that Mr. Fletcher could plead damages claims for how she supervised his probationary term. And I want to be clear here, and I want to answer the court's question while reserving my time, so I'm just highlighting that I'm just trying to answer Your Honor's question, but that all we are saying in this case is that Mr. Fletcher was allowed to have a pre-deprivation adversarial process before the state could impose these conditions. The state is doing everything it can to get away with not doing that, nor being put to its proofs on whether it could have convicted him of a sex crime in this case. So the damages claims are that the law was clear that he was entitled to due process before these conditions were imposed on him during prison. So those are damages claims in prison. The state does not dispute that he can amend on that claim. And then on a probation, and he could certainly name the correct defendants for the kind of claim that is not entitled to absolute immunity.
But isn't that claim really about the imposition of those conditions, not about supervising? Is it?
Mr. Fletcher has argued from the beginning that having to go through with those, despite him saying, I am not a sex offender, and being told, if you don't do this, you can choose not to do this. This is in the words of Ms. Clifford. But if you don't, you're going back to jail.
But to the
that is a supervisory.
Is it really supervisory? I mean, you're really complaining about the decision at the beginning of the process that this is going to be the way it's going to work. The supervision is a bit, you know, it's there's nothing going on in the supervision in particular that is the basis for a claim. So isn't that a kind of an end run around the immunity issue?
Perhaps that is something that this court may eventually decide, Your Honor, but that does not mean that my client, who is pro se, should not be allowed to at least attempt to amend his complaint to name the correct defendants for that kind of claim, which this court clearly says is not entitled to absolute immunity.
All right, we'll give you a chance to have a brief rebuttal.
Good morning, and if it may please the court, Deputy Attorney General Brian Church on behalf of the state defendants in this case. I want to address the court's questions, but I also want to note that this court should affirm that a parole commission may constitutionally impose conditions designed to help protect society from offending behaviors and rehabilitate a parolee from offending behaviors. Unlike the Neal case, the Idaho Commission on Pardons and Parole has made no classification of Mr. Fletcher as a sex offender. It's not labeled him, classified him, or designated him as a sex offender. And there's
Counsel, I don't know what to make of that argument, because the standard operating procedures that are in the record that the Idaho Department of Corrections employs says that it will deem people to be a sex offender if they are convicted of a sex offense or if a judgment is made that they need that sort of programming in prison.
Well, two responses to that, Your Honor. One, we are here today on behalf of the Idaho Parole Commission decision, which is to impose the parole conditions. Any prison programming issue is moot at this point because Mr. Fletcher was released from prison back in February of 2018, even prior, if I recall correctly, prior to when he brought his complaint in this case.
So are you saying that standard operating procedure doesn't apply to the parole aspect?
And I want to be clear of which standing operating procedure the court is referring to here.
Sure, let me look at it. Hold on.
Because what I'm dealing with, Your Honor, is specifically SER.
No, this is a probation and parole number. So it is 701-04-02-006. This is in the standard operating procedures manual, and it talks about probation and parole, and it says, for the purpose of this standard operating procedure, the term sex offender will be used to identify both individuals who have been convicted of a sex offense and individuals who have been deemed appropriate for sex offender supervision as set forth in the standard operating procedure. And then it goes on to talk about how the, I'm looking for the title. The designee of probation and parole supervision strategies is going to assess whether somebody needs that sort of treatment and therefore is so treated.
Well, and again, just to clarify, so again, we're looking at SER 6667, which are the actual parole conditions themselves that are being challenged by Mr. Fletcher's complaint. The parole conditions are the ones that are coming from the Idaho Parole Commission. Now, you're referencing a policy that is applicable to the Department of Correction as it supervises individuals. But again, I'm not aware of, in this record, of anywhere where any evidence in the record where Mr. Fletcher has been labeled, classified, or deemed a sex offender such that there would be some type of stigmatizing consequences from that, like a sex offender registration.
So, I mean, is that your argument, though, that you can only be formally labeled a sex offender if you have a registration requirement? That's the bottom line of your argument?
It's either going to be a formal classification through a sex offender type registration or some other formal categorization of the person in accordance with some kind of policy.
Well, I just read you one. That's what I'm getting at. I mean, your argument is he hasn't been labeled as a sex offender. This thing says you get labeled as a sex offender in two ways, and one of the ways applies to him. So I don't understand your argument that he wasn't given that label. He clearly was.
Well, and I'm not sure that the appellant has actually raised that SOP. I'd have to look back at the appellant's brief, but I don't recall the appellant raising that SOP as the basis of their argument. The other thing I would note for the court's benefit is this seems to be an internal designation used by the Department of Corrections to help identify which parole officers are going to be in the best position to help Mr. Fletcher as he continues in his parole and in his rehabilitation.
I get all of the reasons why the correction system would want to have the ability to do this. I get all of that. But under Neil says that it doesn't have to be a public registration, a public labeling. It can be an internal structure that creates that consequence. So how do you get around that case?
Well, I think two ways. One, I'm not certain that Neil indicates that it is purely an internal structure. I recognize in Neil what happens there is you've got an act that allowed or authorized the parole commission to, one, designate persons as sex offenders, and two, to impose conditions based upon that, namely conditions as to parole eligibility. Here, at least for the parole commission, that's not the case where Mr. Fletcher was not designated a sex offender. Instead, the parole commission issued the parole conditions 66 to 67 of the SCR based upon an individualized assessment of his offending behaviors. And that came back to Judge Bybee's question at the beginning with respect to the motion to take judicial notice. And I want to address that real quick as to even why I put that in. I was concerned here by our brief's reference to the fact that Mr. Fletcher had rubbed the vaginal opening of a 4-year-old child and trying to determine where that came from, and determined based upon the amended information that the amended information alleged that it was either a 5-year-old or 8-year-old child. Part of the confusion here, though, came from, and it's going to be approximately SCR 38 or 39, in Mr. Fletcher's surreply to the motion for summary judgment at the district court. And it's actually page 41, excuse me. And there's a paragraph where it says, truth, Mr. Fletcher gave the victim a bath and washed her with too much soap at age 4, which was the complaint in the discovery. That's why I wanted to make sure the record was clear that the actual amended information in this case was based upon an age 5 or age 8 minor child. Regardless, the plea here was to the felony injury to a child, to wit, of the age of 5 and or 8 years of age by rubbing the vaginal opening of the child's name, or child's initials, at least as it was. Now, with respect to Judge Bybee's questions, the state, I think, did raise the issues here with respect to, and I'm pointing to pages 8, 7, 24, and 28 of the state's brief. Page 7, we note that Mr. Fletcher had to participate in a psychosexual evaluation. Page 8, we note that Mr. Fletcher voluntarily entered into the parole conditions agreement. Page 24 and 28, we've got additional arguments there about Mr. Fletcher completing the psychosexual treatment or evaluation, excuse me, and treatment in prison. And at page 28, we've got an argument here that this case is unlike the Neal prisoner, but more like the Martinez prisoner in Neal, specifically because Mr. Fletcher pled guilty to rubbing the vaginal opening of the child. Now, the one thing that's different about Neal, and this is actually from the appellant's further excerpts of record, and I'd point the court to page 33 and 32, and this is the first one of the first charges. The factual basis of the charge for Mr. Neal in that case was, I took jewelry without permission from Nolani Pollock, or Pocock. The other charge was based on I and other defendants, this is at FER 28, I and other defendants kidnapped, terrorized, and assaulted Michael Warner. Clearly a very different scenario from the charge that we have here of rubbing the vaginal opening. which is why the state has argued that that was that plea agreement to that charge was sufficient for due process purposes, even if this court believes there was a liberty interest at stake with respect to those questions. I did want to touch, Chief Judge Seaborg, on your question about the amended complaint as well. The amended complaint, the defendants have, one, argued that the district court properly denied or dismissed the claims against the defendants Jones and Clifford, the executive director of the Pardons and Parole, and the District 4 deputy manager. We argued that those were correctly dismissed because Mr. Fletcher's complaint itself, as we've quoted in the brief, states that they are being sued in their official capacity.
Isn't that awfully harsh on a pro se litigant? It's a very technical line to draw when you look at the nature of the claim, and it's conducive. I'm not saying it would ultimately be a viable claim, but it's plainly he's going after them in a individual capacity. So to say he checked the box or whatever he did, isn't that kind of a doesn't that run into problems with the liberality we're supposed to accord to pro se litigants?
Well, a couple of responses to that, Your Honor. One, generally the liberality or the presumption of suing somebody in individual capacity, as I understand, comes from when the complaint is not clear into what capacity a person is being sued. Here it's very clear, again, because it's written in Mr. Fletcher's own hand, that he is suing them, and this is at SER 136, suing them in their official capacity. The
counsel,
court would have to...
In some respects, that is... it may be naivete on his part as to why that's important. He may not even understand the legal distinction between doing that. It may be simply a way of designating who precisely it is that he's suing. These are common names. He wants to make clear that these are people who have exercised some control over him. It seems a really, really tight reading of this complaint, and that you would not allow him the opportunity to amend.
Well, let me respond to that in twofold. One, the reading is important here because of the relief he is seeking with respect to the injunctive relief. Remember, it's the injunctive relief against the official, in this case, the executive director of the pardon Commission on Pardons and Parole, that would grant some relief here, removing conditions.
Right. And then right below that, he is also seeking $150,000 in damages.
And I agree, Your Honor, he certainly is. But the problem is the district court shouldn't be changing what the actual...
Right. Then you can allow him to amend. But he's obviously seeking damages. He can't seek damages. He can't seek injunctive relief against them in their individual capacity. So, I mean, he's kind of been whipsawed here on some legal distinctions that I think a lot of people don't understand. But it's pretty obvious what he wants to do here. This would not be an unusual suit. It wouldn't be like, oh, we didn't realize that he really wanted to sue them in their individual capacity. Of course he does.
Sure, and I understand Your Honor's point, but I guess my point is we don't want to misread or mischaracterize what he actually wrote here and change what he wrote. But the district court took your
argument. Can I just follow up on Judge Bybee's question? I understand your argument. I do think it's hyper-technical because to a lay person, I think they would say, I want to sue this person for what they did because they're an official governmental officer. I'm not suing them for their personal activities. Not that they understand the fine distinction between officer, official capacity, and individual capacity. But putting that aside, are you also making a futility argument or not?
I am, Your Honor, and that's based upon because the district court went there itself, recognizing that, and as you've pointed out, any claim here is really traced back to the imposition of these conditions themselves. Thornton certainly recognizes that some arbitrary, unconstitutional enforcement of an otherwise valid condition could result in a claim, but that's not what we have here from Mr. Fletcher. Mr. Fletcher's full complaint is the fact that the parole commission said he had to complete a sex offender evaluation, he couldn't access pornography, and the other conditions that he's challenged. That's why it's futile here, because these individuals, even if they were sued in their individual capacity, are simply there because they are the ones who've got these conditions here. They're the ones who've got these conditions imposed and are just monitoring them. Really, it's a challenge to the imposition of these conditions, Your Honor, that's really at issue.
Is there any case law that develops that concept that you're aware of that, well, it really isn't a supervision issue, it's a imposition issue, and if all the probation officer is doing is just following the provision as intended, that doesn't implicate supervision for purposes of a 1983 case?
Sure, Your Honor. I think I was basing my understanding on the Thornton case that the district court itself had cited. I would have to go back and do additional analysis of other cases that have looked into that. If the court wanted to, I can certainly provide that. But I think Thornton's clear enough that any time it's the actual conditions that are imposed that's being challenged, that is subject to absolute immunity. And if I could also address the court's order regarding the mootness issue, I think it's clear as of May 20th of 2023, not only do Mr. Fletcher's parole conditions end, his commitment to the Idaho Board of Correction ends, such that he is going to be a free man as of May 20, 2023. And so any objective or declaratory relief would be moot as of that date. Obviously, to the extent the panel believed that there was a damages claim, yes, technically it's not moot, but as I've noted before, one, it's either subject to dismissal because he named them in their official capacity and subject to dismissal under will, or it's subject to dismissal on the basis of the futility argument based on their absolute judicial immunity. And we haven't even had a chance yet, of course, if the court allows us to go back to address qualified immunity here. Given the very different circumstances here between Neal and this case, and so with that, I think I'll...
I have a couple of additional questions. To follow up on some of the questions that Judge Bybee had for your friend in this case, paragraph 11 of the plea agreement talks about the defendant agrees to follow all recommendations of the psychosexual evaluation should he be placed on probation after the retained jurisdiction. So that didn't happen here. The court didn't retain jurisdiction. Probation never happened. He's sent to prison. We're talking about parole. So my question is, the parole department had the ability to impose the conditions that it had because he had the conviction, and then the Idaho rules allow it to look at the facts underlying the conviction in figuring out what treatment, that sort of thing. So is your argument then that even though his plea agreement specifically called out what might happen on probation, that's a distinction without a difference here, even though it happened through the parole process?
Well, I think there are two different arguments to that, if I may respond to your question. I think the two different arguments, one, the fact of the plea agreement and the amended information that was also put in through the judicial notice put him on notice that he was pleading guilty to conduct that is certainly sexually offending behavior. I think we can all agree rubbing the vaginal opening of a minor child certainly qualifies as that. So that's the first basis for why the parole commission here can act, as Your Honor noted, under Idaho Code 20-1004 and its implementing regulations, in looking at the conduct that underlies the conviction itself and conduct that he entered an Alford plea, which is a guilty plea in the Ninth Circuit, too. The second thing is, I think I would agree with you that there was at least a recognition, not only through probation, but through some type of out-of-prison monitoring there, in that case through probation specifically, but here through parole, where he could be subject to certain conditions that related to the sexual nature of the offense, even though it's not a registrable sex offense under the Idaho Code.
Well, that's the thing that's the rub here for me, because it seems a little bit unfair, triggering perhaps a due process idea, that the state can get everything it wants in terms of the control over what it deems to be a sex offender, even though it didn't get a sex offense conviction.
I don't think that's unfair, Your Honor, because the purpose here of the parole is to, one, rehabilitate the offender, two, to protect society, and three, to discourage behavior that might lead to reoffending.
But the state knew from the outset he didn't want a sex offense. That's why the negotiations happened the way they did. That's why the plea was what it was. He wasn't going to plead to a sex offense. That mattered to him. And yet, here we are in this case, and the state's position is, doesn't really matter that you didn't plead to a sex offense. We get all of the authority we would have had anyways. How is that fair?
Well, I think it's fair because we're not taking a hyper-technical reading of the plea agreement and the charge here in the sense of, again, I agree, he got a good plea deal in the sense of getting a felony injury to a child, but that felony injury to a child was specifically charged as the conduct we've described earlier. We have to look at this conduct in the terms of the whole, not just this hyper-technical reading of what is a registrable offense, because as I understand the court's precedent, it's not just whether it's a registrable offense or not that matters. In fact, that is plainly appellant's argument in this case, is it's more than just the fact that he was required to not required to register. If that's the case, then we get to benefit from that argument as well, because again, yes, I agree, he was not charged with convicted of an offense for which he has to register, but the offense was specifically charged as rubbing the vaginal opening of a minor child, and that's sexually offending behavior, Your Honor.
Any further questions?
For these reasons, we ask that you affirm. Thank you very much.
All right, Mr. Wifter, we took your colleague over, so we'll give you 3 minutes for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. I want to just make a few points. The state nowhere argued that it would be futile for Mr. Fletcher to amend his complaint to plead damages claims for his time in prison, and it was their burden to do so. So at a minimum, this court should remand with leave to replead that claim. Two, as the state argued, the plea in Neal was that he, quote, kidnapped and assaulted, end quote, the victim. The factual basis for the assault was, quote, inserting the unnamed juvenile male's penis into the victim's mouth. And then third, the state itself has now acknowledged that unconstitutional enforcement of parole conditions is not entitled to absolute immunity. And the state did not say in its rebuttal that Mr. Fletcher could not plead such claims, that such claims would be futile to plead. Judge Forrest, I did want to highlight that you were absolutely correct about the parole conditions here that said that he can be labeled a sex offender by being convicted of a sex offense, or if a judgment is made that they need that kind of programming. That is exactly on all fours with the program that was deemed unconstitutional in Neal without pre-deprivation process. And at bottom, all we have argued from the outset is that Mr. Fletcher and those like him are due adversarial process before they can be required to undergo these invasive sex offender treatments when they are not convicted of a sex crime. None of us would undergo such treatment unless we were required to do so under the coercive power of the state because of how much stigma is attached to that kind of label. And if it wants to require this of Mr. Fletcher, it either had to obtain a sex offense conviction or provide him adversarial process beforehand. It cannot be that adversarial process is too much to ask of the state before it can take away an individual's liberty.
Counsel, do you agree that if we can't get a decision out before your client is released from supervision, that this, at least as to everything but damages, this case is moot?
I think if this court chooses not, and we would like to affirmatively ask right now that in enjoying these conditions pending the decision, we didn't make that motion because it wasn't until late in the day that this court asked the question to begin with. But short of that, we do agree that at the very least, there must be a remand here for repleting the damages claims, even if a decision does not come from this court before May 21st. And it is May 21st, I believe, not May 23rd.
All right.
Thank you, Your Honors.
All right. Thank you for your argument. The matter of Fletcher versus the Idaho Department of Corrections is submitted.